video for herself. She's been nominated by the Moscow Times as one of the 10 Russian entrepreneurs to watch. So she will give a very interesting and a perspective presentation on her vision of corporate life and startup life. So please welcome Olga Steidl.
Oh, yeah, microphone works. That's good. Oops. Do you hear me? No? Now? A little bit? Should I speak up? Yeah, a little bit. Cool. As Janet says, my name is Olga. If I will be, like, if you need me to speak up, just let me know. If you need me to go down, just let me know. Like, I can, yeah, walk, talk, jump, everything. So, let me tell me why I'm here. So the topic is pretty, I would say, broad, you know. You can talk about everything here. But it was really challenging for me to find out what to tell you because I have a lot of things in my head going on all the time about am I a startup person, am I a corporate person? Because as you will find out later, I was in both boats at the end of my days. So today I'll tell you a little bit about my perspective, about how I work, about what I think, which kind of people I hire for my team, because I said I'm now a startup CEO before being a vice president in a corporate company. Why I'm actually allowed to present here is because, as I said, both corporate and both startup is in me. I prepared some kind of a slide. There wasn't really a point of the slide, so it's just nice pictures I like. And it's more about what I will tell you, and it's not about what is written there. Or there, you can't even read this. So don't really try. So more or less what I wanted to tell you, why I'm allowed to stand here, it's because when I was 15 years old, I understood, you know, I don't like school. I know, like, school is boring. You know, you're 15, you go to school, you don't do anything. So instead of going to school, I found myself a job. So I was in school, but I found myself a job. And between my 15th and my 18th birthday, I was typing in like 20 PhD papers about economy and about management. And at this particular point, I decided, it's interesting. It's like, you know, someone needs to rule the world, and I can do that. And maybe I should go and study management. And, you know, when you study management and you're in business school, you think corporate is everything. So it actually implies you going to a corporate and starting your corporate career. So when I was 20, I went to a corporate. I was working for one of the, as far as I'm Russian, so I'm from St. Petersburg originally, so I was working for the biggest brewery in Russia, then I was working for Gillette Company installing like ERP systems. Then what I was trying to do is to work to telecommunication company. It's almost the same size as Telekom Germany, so German Telecom, yeah. I was the marketing manager there. Then I was invited by a big corporation to join them still during my studies. So you need to understand, during my studies, I was working full-time as well. So I was invited to be a corporate marketing manager at a big corporation in Russia. And I said, you know, it's kind of cool, but I don't really like how you make your decisions. I don't really like people I work with. I don't really like, for example, this is like typical example I have all the time. In a big telecommunication company, I had a computer in front of me, and I was not allowed to show the information on my computer to any of my colleagues. So on the other hand, I had a camera behind me. So it means like every security guy could come to the screen and see what happens on my computer. So I was working there for a year like this, like closing with my whole body, my computer, not showing everyone what I do there. And it was kind of annoying, you know, and you're not allowed to send private emails via a corporate account. So what I was doing with my friend, so she worked at Wrigley at that moment, I worked at Gillette Company, we were sending emails like, dear, to your concern, and then every 10 emails, we tried to hack the system, we tried to send something private. So I was saying something, dear security guy, if you read this, massage is needed in the room number 10. I think we send emails back and forth for 3 months. And after that, my boss calls me and says, you know that you're not allowed to send a personal emails. I'm like, yeah, I do. Kind of, you know, I'm blonde. I can pretend being blonde. And he, you know, but you're not allowed to do this, and I need to fire you right now. And the next thing he said to me was pretty amazing, because I was sitting there, I'm 21, it's my first big job, I'm a marketing manager at a telecommunication company, and he says, but you're lucky, I liked it. I read it through and I liked it. And then I thought that I will never work for a corporation again, because if this person is a boss, is allowed to read any email I send, it sucks, you know. You can send to your friend, I don't know, let's go for lunch, and then your boss shows up because he read your email. It's not good. And then on the other hand, I thought there are still people in a corporation who like to laugh and who like to do things and who are really passionate about something. So I decided to go to startup. I joined a startup. It was 2004, 2005. Honestly, at that moment, I didn't know what startup is. I thought that four people in a room, it's something cool, but I didn't know that it is a startup. They are building something. They were building e-recruiting system. And from this story, I learned if a startup CEO starts to throw pots with flowers in you, you need to run. So I had to twice, because I was a marketing manager who was convinced, we need to change the product, this is the product, we need to grow that. And the CEO was convinced, no, this is my vision, and you need to keep it like this. So I got some pots in my hat, and I ran away. So the second startup I joined, I stayed in this startup for 6 years. I built this company with my colleagues. So we built it from 20 developer team, 120 developer team, which we sold last year to one of the biggest internet companies in Europe, which is Nasdaq traded company called Yandex. So if you don't know what is it, it's the biggest search engine in Russian. They do Russian, they do Ukrainian, Kazakhstan, Turkish language, etc. So what we were doing the best sold user interface for mobile phones. So it was Android, it was Windows Mobile, Symbian. So we're building those devices. So some of the devices you sold, like Sony Ericsson devices, Toshiba devices, Huawei ZTE devices, we built the user interface. So we were like the team of HTC Sense, but for any other device manufacturer out there. And I was the vice president of mobile, of marketing, of sales, etc. So at the end of the day, I was like vice president of global marketing, which actually meant that I do blah, blah, blah in emails. So it was I wasn't coding at all. The second product we had is mobile television. And we sold it to all mobile operators in Europe, in Asia. We had Singaporean mobile operators, 3 out of 4, Russian mobile operators, 2 Indian mobile operators, Brazil, etc. So we sold the company. So the whole story leads to that in November 2011, I was selling my company. You know, I was at the moment when I'm on the board of 120 employee team, and I know that tomorrow the company will be sold. And tomorrow my team will get to know that actually they're getting a corporation. We were in a startup, and we were leading to the company, which is at least 40 times bigger than we are. And we will be a part of this whole machine. So, you know, I became a vice president of the biggest internet company in Europe with my 27. So I was 27 when I became vice president of mobile ecosystem. So I was in charge of a whole mobile partnership, mobile strategy in this company. I learned my lesson again. I stayed there five months to see how corporate is being built, how decisions are made, what kind of people are working there, and I started it again. So since March 2012, I'm a startup CEO again, and we're building a social push-to-talk service. But let me come a little bit back to what a startup is. So just raise your hand, okay? Do you think that startup is a free developer team? Who thinks so? Free developer team, is it a startup? Just, I will do 2 hands. Who thinks of, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people think. Who thinks that startup is a 100 developer team? Do you think it is a startup? It's actually, yes, this is a startup. If you look at Google last, I think 2 weeks ago, yeah, they bought Wildfire. When Google bought Wildfire had 400 employees. and they consider it to be a startup. Then you look at us, like when we were at SPP, we had 120 employees, we had 10 years of experience, we had no debt, we had no venture money at all. And actually, frankly speaking, ability to build a company with our own money without taking any venture money helped us to gain some respect in front of investors and buyers after all when we were selling the company. If you look at Austria, for example, I've been living in this, like I used to live in this country for some time. So now I live in Switzerland. So I'm moving from one German speaking country to another one. I've already been in Germany, so Germany is not on the list anymore. So Austria has more people working in small companies, like small family businesses or one person companies than in corporations. And it's like, do you consider these people working for a startup? I do, but you know, you never heard maybe about Austria being a startup arena or a startup capital as Berlin is, though their whole economy of this country comes from startup people, comes from entrepreneurs. So I work with a lot of investors and incubators right now who say, we don't need startups because we don't really know what startup is. But we need entrepreneurs. We need people who can build something, who will build business, maintain it, and then grow it. Yeah. So as we said, we don't know what a startup is. You know, at the end of the day, when I was selling the company I worked at, I thought, you know, software company, startup company, innovation company in technical world is actually code and people, nothing else. Like, it doesn't matter how big the code is, you know. The smaller the better. It doesn't matter how many employees you have, 400 or two people at the end of the day. This is all about code and people. And one very important thing for you to understand is when you sell a company or when someone buys your company, so for example, you are a buyer, you work at Google, you look at the company and you say, I do buy this company because it's, I don't know, HR deal. Which means HR deal, we're buying this awesome people to work for us. The truth is, when you buy a company, you buy code and computers this code was written on. So you buy equipment and you buy the piece of code. And you think you buy people, but you don't buy people. You actually buy allowance to ask these people, to invite these brilliant people to work for you, to be nice, and you know, to say, we also have cookies, you know. Yeah, you had cookies, we also have cookies. You had office in the south of the city, we also have office in the south of the city. Do you want to work for us, please? You know, and not so many people really stay, unfortunately. So, do you use Sparrow? Who uses Sparrow? I use Sparrow. No one uses Sparrow, no one uses Mac. I don't know why. So Sparrow was bought by Google as well. I'm really afraid for Sparrow, you know? I'm really afraid that this service won't work. Because I paid for that. And I saw so many people just posting, give us our money back, we paid for the service and you've sold it to Google, it will just break down and I don't want to use the service anymore. Okay. Then, you know, the whole, this is more closer to Berlin, like daily deal thing. I saw so many daily deal people on the market I can hire. I'm like, for me, it's a brilliant situation. I'm a startup CEO, I need people. I need really quality people out there. But as a person who's been in a corporate world, I'm really unsatisfied with the situation when I kind of bought this knowledge and I bought this experience, but people left the country, a company, and they went to do something else. You know, there is a guy, the Foursquare founder, Darius Crowley, who said publicly that he's really unsatisfied with Google. I'm not, you know, looking at my experience, I'm not really the person who will tell you I will never work for Microsoft. I will work for Microsoft, why not? I will work for Yahoo, for example, after Marisa Mayer joined it. I'm like, I will be first on the list, but, you know, I have a different attitude. When I look at my company, I don't want to build a company which will be like Sparrow sold in a year. Of course, it's nice to have like some cash there, but on the other hand, I want to build a sustainable product. When you look down there, what is the difference between these startups they buy and the corporations? There are not many differences, actually, because everyone, like I hate startup people when they start blame corporations because really shows me they never worked for one and they never sold to one. It's like two really important things. So first important thing, if you never worked for a corporation, you don't know how to sell to them, which means you don't understand that at the end of the day, your clients are not only users. Your clients are also corporations. Your clients, in some way you want to sell it to Google, or in some way you want to have a white label solution and you want to sell it to mobile operators. So you need really to understand the structure of corporate. You need to understand why it takes them 10 days to pay you when you can pay in one day. You think, okay, they're so slow, but you don't understand the process. Sometimes you sell to the wrong person. You sell to a person in, I had the situation, I was telling it about it to a friend of mine. We were building mobile television service, which means we worked with mobile operator to provide them a white label solution. Customized server size, customized client size. We were allowed to advertise it on mobile because we were dealing with mobile department. But then we understood that there is no advertising of the service on a desktop just because no one from us ever contacted a person from a desktop desktop department because they never knew that the mobile department is doing mobile service. It's okay, honestly. If you don't understand the corporate structure, it means you don't know how to scale your own company. There is a really easy test. If you have a company, if you start a company and you have more people with the C-level positions than managers, you're screwed. You're like, you will never build your product. You're like CEO, CDO, CMO, CC something, etc. You see something, but you never do the something. Yeah. Which means you need managers who will actually code on the back. So I have a 10 developer team sitting and really coding right now while I'm talking to you. Yeah, they're really in the product, and I don't want them to be distracted from the product. You need really people who will grow your company, which means you need to understand where you go. The closer you get to the point where you're 100 people, the closer you get to a corporate structure. If you don't understand the corporate structure, you don't understand your own company. So think about that. Let's talk about motivation. Yeah, we say, I want to be a startup because I want to be my own boss. True, for me as a CEO, for my CTO, because he's kind of a partner for me, and we decide everything together. But any other person in the company, even if you're in a startup, you have a boss. And this boss decides how the product looks like. Of course, you have more freedom and more power to change the product than maybe any other corporate person out there. But you still have a boss. And every single startup needs to understand that. Then, about changing product. I had this interesting discussion with my former colleague. My former colleague said, I left Microsoft because when I was talking to people and explaining what I do, it was the following dialogue. So he said, do you know Microsoft Office? Everyone's like knocking. Like, do you know Word? Yeah. Do you know Menu? Do you know Edit? Or, I don't know, File? Said, yeah, do you remember the button save? I'm for the bottom save. So he was doing in the Microsoft this particular function for like 7 years. It's not a bad thing. Like, I don't think it's a bad thing. No, I see the face of the guy out there in a t-shirt. It's not a bad thing. It's just way to focus. It's a way to focus for a corporation's specific needs. It's a way to focus on specific functions. If you can't focus, it's a really bad thing. So for example, for me, I can go to 20,000 events out there every year. But if I can't focus and I can't justify, this is my product, this is what we do, we don't do that because we can't. Because otherwise, I have 20,000 startups ideas out there. I can share them with you, because if you do them, it will be great. But I can't do 20 startups in a day. Like, I need to be focused. It's better than meditation or yoga or something, just focusing on that. About motivation, we're coming back to motivation. Yeah, you say startup is better because we don't have boss. And next thing, what motivates me in a startup that I actually get something from it, like shares or equity or anything like this. Statistically, 90% of a startup employees don't get any shares. They get salary. And the easiest thing in a startup is for like CTO, CEO, or someone out there deciding what kind of salary you will get, is actually to say, this is just stable amount and you get it every month. That's why when you come to sell something to a corporation, you see a problem. Because you don't understand how corporate people are motivated. Which kind of bonus do they have? Maybe you have, coming back to the mobile television service, yeah, we had. You talk to a person who is in charge of device customizations, or he's in charge of selling advertising, or he's in charge of selling other services. You need to know what user, like what this client of yours gets when he becomes your service, like when he buys your service as a buyer. One friend of mine, he gave me a perfect example how you need to deal with corporate people. You know, he had a couple of discussions with a client when the client was kind of okay with signing a contract, but on the other hand, really, you know, not willing to proceed any further. So, and he kept asking what happens there, why are you not signing it, can we do the service better, maybe we need to talk to another person because it's your boss who decides. He said, no, it's me, it's everything fine. And then in the conversation, the friend of mine just finds out that the guy wants a swimming pool. Yeah, he wants a swimming pool, which means, hi Patrick, that's a Patrick story. Which means that the bonus the guy gets is exactly enough to build a swimming pool in his yard if they meet the commercial goals. So you need to be sure the guy you're dealing with gets what he wants. The guy got a swimming pool at the end of the story, but maybe in your case it's a car or something else. Like, you know, it's usually either something with kids, either something with health or food. Only three things, nothing else. But people do like this, you know. They like it. And I like corporations, actually. So when I worked as a vice president, the biggest challenge for me was to be, to delegate. This is the problem of all startup people I have. I know, and who out there. You want to do everything by yourself. You want to sit down, you want to code. And then you want to write a press release, and then you want to do a banner, and want to do something else. But unfortunately, I'm not as good in coding as my CTO, because he is a technical guy. I'm half technical, half marketing. So I need to delegate it to him. I need to be sure that he knows his task, and he's fully in charge of his task. It's really hard for me personally because I'm a control freak, you know. I'm trying to dig into the code as well, and then he's like, come on, just stop doing that. And you can spend your time differently. But that's what I learned from a corporation. You have people helping you. So you have people like lawyers, you have people like bookkeepers who've done this before. Don't do bookkeeping by yourself. Like I made my mistakes, I don't want to do anymore. Like, you know, honestly, this was my story. So I was, my bank account, my company bank account was closed for 2 months because of me. Now I have an operational director who helps me. But it comes from the, you know, I'm a startup, I can do everything. You can't, unfortunately. You need people to help you out there. Also corporate people, why I like them, because when you concentrate on a particular task, so you say, I need to have an event. We had awesome event team at the company I worked for, which means you come to them and they do everything. It's a different mindset. In startup, you want to have different, like completely different people. You want to have a marketing person who comes to you in the morning, shows you press release. And during the day, he works in a Photoshop. And in the evening, he sits with your clients during the lunch. But in a corporation, you just want brand managers who can glue together internal and external functions. Like, for example, I had this example when developers from one department thought that branding of our company looks differently, and it's funky to add a couple of more colors to that, you know. And it happens all the time. It happens when, for example, you're a NASDAQ trade company, and you need to be sure that external press team doesn't write something which crashes your stock price, because only you know how to do that. Of course, these people then in a corporation are not suitable for a startup because they can't do anything but them, but themselves. So it's not like doers, it's more managers, you know? In a startup, you need to be more like Milos Forman. You know, Milos Forman, he is an American film director. So once in his interview, he said, I am as a film director, can do everything in the movie. I can be an actor, I can be a cameraman, I can write scenario, but I do it pretty bad. So that's the same about a startup CEO or a startup person. If you look at the average developer at startup company, the average developer at Google will be much better in digging into a specific thing. But then why startup people, what startup people good at is having dialogue in their heads. What I mean, it was, you know, it was advice I got from my former boss who said, if you want to build a startup, hire people who have internal dialogue in this box. Which means you want a person who sits down in front of a computer and while building something has a marketing and development department discussion in his box. He understands where it comes from. When he builds the user interface, he not only understands the design, but he also understands the Android SDK, because I come from the mobile world. Yeah, for me, it's SDKs, APIs, blah, blah, blah stuff. So he understands the Android SDK and understand what's possible, what's not. So you need these people like Milos Forman who can actually do everything but that, more or less. But at the end of the day, they are more effective in building companies. They are more effective in ending projects. They are more effective into being research and development department. Because why startups are bad? Because they're kind of research and development units for the companies who buy them, you know? I don't want to tell you that being a startup is kind of a nice thing. I'm like, honestly, I'm scared every day. So, and it's really good if you're scared every day and if you're freaking out. Like one of my business partners, he always says, like, if you don't freak out every week, you're not in a startup. And you need to freak out. You need to be insecure. You need to feel the pressure from all the sides. But you don't need to give, you don't need to allow to your team to feel the pressure. And that's all I learned also from the corporate. There are layers of information. One of the biggest mistakes startups do is they tell everyone everything. So you have 10 developer team or marketeers or anyone else on the team, and you tell every single piece of information you have to them. You distract them, you annoy them, and you scare them. Don't tell anyone anything what you're not really, like you say, for example, okay, we will have this marketing contract by the end of this month, and we will have this amount of money coming in. Honestly, your developer team doesn't want to know this, because then they will end up thinking about, okay, this amount of money, we will la la la, and this is my salary, and this is la la la. So they will be distracted all the time. Keep the like information layered all the time, even in a startup. That's a good thing for a corporate. I'm scared, you know, like I don't think that any person in this room and behind me and behind me and behind me, they will ever tell you what's the next big thing, because they don't know. And if they tell you they don't know, just, you know, forget about this, because all this all startup person, they are trying and failing, and it's being a startup person is an ability to fail. That's the main thing. On the other hand, I really value risk-taking corporate people more than risk-taking startup people, because risk-taking corporate people just have to lose more to achieve something. So they have to stand up in front of the board of 40 members and say, no, damn, I think like this, and we should do like that, and we will go there. And it takes more courage to be in this situation to say no than in a situation of a startup, and to be a startup CEO and say, no, we will do like this, because I decided. About risk-taking, again, it's not about money, not at all, because a lot of people, when I say, you know, corporate people, when they are risk-taking, they have more value, for me, in my opinion. it's not about money, because actually more startups died because they're overfat than, like, you know, getting more money than they need than to get less money than they need. More startups just spending more. And it's a very crucial thing. You need to really know how much money do you need to sustain the team and be in a situation when I'm always in a situation saying, no, I want the lower price. No, I want to pay less. No, how can we do it alternately? I have an investor who invested into our company, and I'm in a position where I can afford to hire the best people, but I can't afford to spend money just on spoiling them. Just telling them, yeah, just, you know, we will do the marketing campaign. We will invite BBDO or any other marketing agency and do the marketing campaign for them. You know, we will pay $1 million after a year for nothing, for maybe a Facebook page with 300 likes. I have 600 friends on Facebook. I can do it like in a day, you know. I don't need to go to agency, but what happens to your startups when it is spoiled? I really want to inspire you for one thing. If you're doing startup, keep doing that. Because the worst thing that can happen to you is actually that you go to corporate. And in the case of a country I live in, you go to bank or insurance company. That's not the worst thing, and maybe it's the best thing which happened to you in your life. Because you're a corporate person more than a startup person. And please, when you see a corporate person, don't blame him for being, I don't know, or you're working on a small thing in the small country company. He's actually a high professional in his particular field. But just this professional is not needed in your company. The other way around works as well. Some of the employees in your company, they are not needed in a corporate. That's why maybe when you sell your company, or your employees go and try to find a place in a corporate, they won't be accepted. Because it's just another set of people. Just another set of skills and another set of experience. So, thank you so much. I think there were, like, if you have any questions, you can ask me. But it's more or less my history of what I'm doing, my opinion, how you can hire people. And thank you so much. There are so many people here. Actually, I didn't expect anyone to come. No question. Someone had a question. If you can speak loud, I can repeat your question if you want to. Okay.
Oh, hi. Hi. Thank you for coming. That's the first thing. And I actually wanted to ask, because there is so many people in corporates in terms of maybe financiers, management consultants, investment bankers wanting
them
to go to startups.
Yeah.
Because there is so much hype around it. And because they're non-technical, what would be your advice, basically, or how to get going in a startup world, or how to make a successful company?
Mm-hmm. So for me, I have a trick. Yeah. So I studied IT management. So I studied how to build ERP systems and then sell them. Like people like you come to me and ask the same question. I had this conversation last week. The best tip, find a CTO. Find a person who is really passionate about technology and who doesn't have a clue about marketing management, building companies. Try not to scare him out with a position of CTO, because real people who want to build technology, they are scared about position CTO. You can call him, you are a mentor. And you'll be a mentor. So you need the technical part. You need definitely. And on the other hand, you need to learn at least a little bit how a technical world functions. So for example, just to give you an example, I can tell you what chipset is in your phone, what kind of device manufacturer built it, how much every connector costs on this phone. Because we were dealing with device manufacturers. When you're dealing with such people, you need to know every single detail. On the other hand, there are really situations, then you don't need to know technical details. I had a project when we were building screens in bags, like handbags for women. So you put the screen in a handbag, it's the same thin screen as in a Kindle. And you connect it via Bluetooth with your phone. So you take a picture, for example, Telefonica, I like the Telefonica logo, and you got it on the back. So I learned everything about, you know, how to glue it, where do you need a connector, what's the file transfer system is there, how we can, where we store data, where is the battery, And it's in the front of the designer who was actually buying my product. And she looks at me, says, do you glue it? If so, how you can cut it? And I'm like, I spent half a year learning the technical details, but I never thought about, you know, design things. And I never thought about how this product will be bought by this particular client. So it really depends on the product, but you definitely need someone who is technical on your team. It's like my husband calls my CTO my working husband. So, you know, you need to trust someone.
Thanks.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, thank you very much.
What's your name?
Anton. I'm Russian as well.
Yeah, I'm I hear that.
I have two questions, basically, if I may. The first one being, you told a lot of stories about a very specific field, and I want to bring the topic back to, what the topic was, mm-hmm. corporate and startup life. Mm-hmm. The common preconception is that, obviously, the startup life entails a lot of freedom, mm-hmm. even though you have a lot of responsibility. Obviously, you say you freak out every week. And
there is no freedom, no.
And
not.
Corporate life it just has, well, stability.
Yeah.
What are your experiences with that?
That's, like, on one hand, it's true. On the other hand, I really hate when someone says that corporate job is 9-to-5. You know, I see my former colleagues who are working right now at the corporate. They're like 5,000 people company on NASDAQ. They work 24/7. They just have different goals to achieve. They have different tasks. They have different, like, on a strategical and tactical level, they have completely different things that are going on, but they're still working 24/7. So I can't say that their life is comfortable in that case. But when you look at this as social security, when you look at this as pension, as, I don't know, cookies in the kitchen, as business class plane tickets, yes, that's true. This is more comfortable. Like, $100,000, I don't know, euros spent every year on one person in a management position in every corporate company. You know, I was talking to Biomed company, pretty big one in Switzerland, and he said, you know, we're cutting our office in Greece because we are losing money and we need to cut somewhere. But then the same person was telling me that they just had this meeting to discuss what they're going to do in Lucerne. So what they did, they brought top management from every single office in the world with the business class to the most expensive hotel in Lucerne. They had the most expensive dinner ever they could have there and decided to close Greece office. You know, this is ridiculous. This is like, you know, the stuff. So in this case, yes, it's more comfortable. So if you, it's not for you, but if you're a girl and you want to get, like, to get pregnant and you want to have, like, kids, it's good to be in corporate because they will really maintain all the stuff. But on the other hand, there is no use. Okay, you will get social security, but it depends from country to country how it built. In a startup life, if you have, if your startup is financed, you also have a lot of privileges. You don't, I don't know, you don't fly a business, but you fly. Yeah, you don't, I don't know, you don't go to a three-star Michelin restaurant, but you go out to eat with your colleagues. You don't really need three-star Michelin restaurant, you know. They're like basic things. Did I answer a question?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's very interesting to get a different view on things. I think the next speaker will be Professor Falti, and he has a very specific view on exactly the workload mm-hmm. and startups. Maybe that will be very
really
interesting.
Really afraid to that I break something on the stage, you know.
I have a second question.
Sure.
You said that you moved to Switzerland and to Austria. What is the startup landscape in Russia, and why did you flee from that?
Why didn't you ask about Austria and Switzerland?
Because I think, well, I worked with Austria and Switzerland. I think I do understand the corporate and
yeah.
the, startup world a little bit in these countries. But Russia mm-hmm. is a personal kind of thing.
Personal interest.
Personal interest, exactly. And everybody warns me about it because there's yeah. so much, you know, racketeering and stuff like that. So,
Come on. You're Russian. You should know that's a bullshit.
Well, a lot of people say, but that's more the traditional side of the
yeah.
business when you open a shop or something like that. What's it like with the high-tech startups?
You know, there are good and bad things about startups in Russia. First thing, we have a lot of startups, and that's a bad thing because they're creepy, they're bad quality, and they're taking money from normal startups, which means I work really close with an investor who invested into our company, and I see how many business plans they get. And out of this business plan, if they get like 200 and one will be at least interesting to talk to, that would be good. So really a lot of people who work into tech, they want to build their companies, they want to be startups, they don't really understand that they need a product to build. If they don't have anything to show, no one wants to talk to them. On the other hand, they really need experience in building companies. And in that point for me as a startup CEO, where they're like really professional startup team, I would say, because I was at Yandex, yeah. Then my CTO was head of mobile in Kaspersky. So we had people from different corporate companies who have experience in building such products. For us, it's hard because we can't hire people at the end of the day. Every single developer want to hire, like for iOS developer, they want to be a startup CTO. It doesn't matter which level they are like juniors from the university and want to be a startup CTO because they think they'll get money out of there. But what I see right now, it's really that it flips a little bit around. So before we had a lot of startups with crappy products. Now we have really 20 startups maybe I can list which had good products and international products. So right now really we're starting not to build copycats, more or less, because everything before was a copycat. I was starting to build really sustainable business, really sustainable products with, yes, development is done in Russia because we have awesome developers, and I will always, like, I interviewed, just an example, yeah, when we were starting the company, I interviewed CTOs in Berlin, Hamburg, Munich, Vienna, Zurich, Kiev, Minsk, St. Petersburg, and Moscow, so nine cities. Top three were from Russia. Top four were from Germany and Russia. So one guy, was on the top four list, was German. And the quality, the balance between quality and price is much better in Russia. But we're building international products. That's the main thing right now that's happening. And there are a lot of venture funds who are really investing and are interested to invest into Russia. So like Index, Mangrove, other bigger guys just come there and start to search for really interesting projects.
Yeah? Marvelous. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Hi.
Hi. You said something which I thought was quite interesting, which was that you thought that in corporate life, you actually had to be a bit more courageous in some ways than with a startup, and that quite surprised me. So I wondered if you could just talk a bit about creativity and how that varies between the two.
Creativity or courage?
Creativity.
Creativity. So, you know, when you're, this is a good example, when you're limited with something, you start to be creative. In startup, you're limited with a lot of stuff. You don't have much money. You don't have that many resources. You maybe have not that many contacts as a big corporation has. And you start to be creative. But on the other hand, no one understands that corporate life is also very limited. You are, my example, yeah, I was building events also for my previous company. So, for example, we would build a huge stand here, 90 square meters, where we present our product. There are two different things you do when you're a startup and when you're a corporate person. When you're a startup, you just, I like green, let's go for green, and you do something. In corporate, you have brand book, you have branding team, which specifically knows how your brand should look like to, for example, to be the same on mobile and to be the same on desktop. You know the colors, you know the fonts, you know everything. You need to talk to them every single day to negotiate how you will build everything. And then at the end of the day, you become more creative because you know how to, you know, go around. But it's more about courage to say no, to say, no, I know how it should be done. And it's courage as well to, it's not really courage, but it's a specific state of mind when you understand that the other person is right as well. Because me as a startup person, I think like, I'm right, you're wrong, let's go. But if you work in a team with 20 marketing managers, you really need to listen to other people, because sometimes, you know, why a lot, so many like startup acquisition got fucked up, you know? There is one single reason for that. There is ego, always. When you put startup people, just acquired startup people, and you put next to them people who acquired them, you have two big egos next to each other, working together on the same product. One team, which is a startup team, thinks, we've done this, we've been there, we know better. The corporate team thinks, we bought them, we're the bosses. They're cool guys on both sides. They're really interesting people, but they start to fight whose product is it, who is the boss. So you really need to be more or less diplomatic to say, I do know what you're saying. I understand what you're talking. I know your position, but I will do like this because I know that. And I take this part of your statement because I understand that that's right, because I never worked with this brand before. And here we can be a little bit more creative because you'd never done this before. We never done this before, but we can check. So this kind of a thing. It's not about creativity itself. It's about finding a solution. Yeah.
Thanks.
Welcome. Unfortunately, I don't hear you.
Hello.
Hi.
You talk about the need for fear to run a business. How do you yourself manage that, and how do you turn it into productive paranoia? And how do you protect your team and your colleagues and your employees from that paranoia?
I will give you two answers, the honest answer and the answer I give to myself when I'm freaking out. Yeah, the honest answer I call Patrick. the answer I give to myself when I have really this paranoia of no, someone done this before, this feature is already on our, like, usually what a startup person can freak about, yeah? So first of all, your product has been copied. Secondly, I don't know, someone has your logo. Third, your competitors just bought out a cool person who can actually change the product to the way it can be. You always need to remember you're better. You're there because you're better. And you need to remember why you're better. So, for example, developer report always helps. So if you see competitor out there, you just send your developer team out there and they crack it. So, and they see how it works. And then we know how we need to build our product to build it, you know. And it's all about, it's like phases, you know. You freak out first, like a couple of hours, you freak out. Then you freak out more. Then you talk to 20 different, like it's for me, it works for me. I don't know how it works for you, but you talk to 20 different people who had experience in specific parts of this problem. So for example, I had really a problem when I thought that our competitor came to the same idea that we want to launch. And I just called the people who worked in a specific field with a specific idea, with a specific audience, and talked through the whole situation. And you get information you never got before. So you talk it through, you talk the whole situation through, and then you get away. First thing, never freak, like, stop, calm down. Second thing, talk to someone just who knows how it works. Third, understand where you're better actually and how you can fix it pretty fast, because sometimes it's just your first perception that it's somehow similar or it's somehow crucial or this is the problem. There is a solution all the time. That's why you're there. You're there to find a solution.
And how do you protect your team from that, and how do you promote productivity rather than destructive paranoia?
I don't freak out in front of them, you know. I'm good at freaking out, but I don't freak out in front of them. So they are working, they know their goals, they know where they are going, they understand the product, they know, like, for example, with a situation when I thought that really we have a competitor out there, I asked my CTO to check it. And when you crack it down, there is nothing. So they are really in a position when they understand this is the field they are working, and this is a hot field, and of course someone will compete with us, and it's good actually. That's extremely good if someone comes out with the same product, because then we see how it develops, because we can't do everything. We limit ourselves. I was telling you about the focus. So we limit ourselves, and if someone steps out a little bit and starts to build a product in this field we're not working at, it's cool. It's really interesting, because then you see how you can link to that. Yeah. But it's really important not to to freak out in front of your team. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Hi, Olga. I also have a question. Whenever I hear about startups, there are two things I always hear. It's the CEO and the CTO. Mm-hmm. Now, should we start a movement against the use of CEO? Because, for example, the banks are also led by CEOs, and I can't see that mm-hmm. young starters have the same thoughts and the same feelings about starting a business than the CEO of a bank. So I think that would also be a good idea to start a movement against the use of CEO, CTO. We are just young people who want to change something and not use these names mm-hmm. that are coming from an old industry and an old organizations that didn't really bring us a good thing.
That's true. I had, you know, some of the friends of mine who work at Google, they from in Seattle, so they came to visit us on weekend in Zurich. And one of the guys, he asked me, what are you actually doing? And I said, I'm a startup CEO. And he laughed at me and said, so you don't have anyone in the team, you're just the only one and you're a CEO. Yeah, cool. And, you know, I was like, yeah, but actually that is how it sounds. It sounds like, if you say I'm a startup CEO, it sounds like I have no one behind me. Because if you say I'm a bank CEO, it's something completely different. You understand you have like 40,000 people working for you, and it's completely different skill. Or for example, I work with I know the CEO of Parallels, the guy who has, I don't know how many thousand people out there, and he has some completely different set of skills. That's why I don't like word startup, I like word entrepreneur. So we're building small businesses, we're building small research labs. Maybe I'm more the head of research lab, I don't know, but definitely I truly agree with you that it's not like my title doesn't show exactly what I do. Because for CEO of the big corporation, like I worked at, it shows what a person does. In my case, it shows what people I don't have on my team right now and whom I substitute. Because right now I substitute, like, I do user interface, I do user experience, I do marketing, I do PR, I do sales, I do freaking amount of other work. But I know that in 1 year, this will be my structure. My structure will look completely differently. And then I will have another role, completely other role in this field. I will be still CEO for the other world, but for myself, I will turn around and be another person. I don't know how to call it, but it's true that it doesn't show what I'm doing right now. Yeah. There is still a hand. I'm surprised there are hands. I thought, you know. Usually people don't ask me anything.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Kai. I have a question. You said, or we heard before, that lots of people in corporate companies are thinking about to move to a startup or become entrepreneurs themselves. But I'm just wondering whether you had experience with people who made this step, but later on maybe they found out they missed an ability or skill or some mindset which made them fail personally. Mm-hmm. And whether you maybe can say, okay, I saw people...
Yeah. Let me repeat your question because I don't hear you that good. So you're asking, have I seen a corporate person going to startup and then understanding that startup mindset doesn't work for him or for
correct.
Her?
Yeah. Okay. Life is not the right one for them and they should have better stayed maybe in the corporate area.
I saw that. I see that right now. There are a couple of startups I advise, and a couple of startups they invite for commercial positions. It's a usual situation when for commercial position you invite someone with contacts, network, and experience in a particular field you're selling to. So for example, if you're a cloud computing company, you will want to invite a person who worked before for a cloud computing company or who sold to the same kind of clients than you want to sell to. There are two things. Like, first thing is hire people with the ability to learn, not only the ability to sell themselves, because usually it's not a situation when a corporate person understands he doesn't fit. it's a situation when a startup CEO understands that this person doesn't fit, because he starts to ask some questions like, okay, what kind of bonus will you pay me at the end if I bring you 10 clients? Or I don't want to go to the trip to, I don't know, I live in Berlin and I don't want to go to trip to Zurich with, you know, with the economy class. So something like this. And you see that at the beginning. And it's usually the startup CEO who understands something doesn't work. Usually, like what I saw in my experience, there was a person who wasn't exactly the corporate, but he was a journalist coming to a PR field of a startup PR field. So when we talked through why it didn't work, he said the following thing, you know, I like to dig the shit, not to cover the shit. So he, as a PR person, had to invent the story why it's cool instead of digging why it's not cool. So you really need to ask the motivation. What's the motivation of you there? Do you want really to maintain your contacts and sell to the same people you are selling to? Or you want to look around and understand how differently it can be done? So, yeah. But it's really hard sometimes to get rid of people. This is the biggest problem. So you can't really sometimes say, I do understand you don't fit to my team, and we need to say goodbye to each other. This is the hardest point of ever. Like, I had this conversation a couple of times in my life. It's the hardest conversation with your employees. But it happens. Like, you have 10 developer team, it happens. You have 20 people on your team, it happens. And it happens every time. And sometimes people need to go, and it's a normal situation. You just need to step and go, you know. I saw we have 5 minutes left, and if anyone wants to answer a last question. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Alessio. Do you think that having some experiences in a corporate environment is needed before starting your own startup?
Before or in between, that would be good. Because, as I said, you understand the structure, you understand who you're selling to, you understand which language they talk to. For example, the typical example I see from the startup people, dress code. This is like, I don't go like this to the meeting, you know. I go like this, I don't know, to the shop here because it's a camp, developer event because developers like, you know, more casual way of thinking. When I go to mobile operator, I go differently, and I know to whom I'm speaking to, how I should address this person, who is his or her boss, and what kind of field in a company they are in charge of. This is the thing you can learn only working in a corporate, and this was really interesting experience for me, being in a corporate and seeing from the inside how it works, because sometimes you just get frustrated because something doesn't happen, and you think that's because corporate is bad, but it's just because you don't understand how it works. So definitely, like, I would really recommend, I would really recommend people to go to corporate at least for a year or two to see how it works. Then not to, you know, irritate the people you work with on the corporate side and, I know, make the same mistakes every person did in their life when they tried to build their company. Because corporates started the same way a startup did. They just, you know, they went through the same mistakes.
Yeah. Thank you.
I think that's it. We don't have any time. So thank you so much. And I hope you will enjoy the next speech.